Okay, good. So let's jump in, okay? And as I said, yeah, so the idea is to help you be more than this person as you go ahead. And what am I doing here? What the heck is that thing? Okay, good. I love this quote from Dostoevsky, who we're going to read. You read as juniors, the beginning of the junior, amazing first semester junior year. Dostoevsky's Brothers Karamazov. But he has this great line where he says, "Man will be saved by beauty," or alternately translated as, "Beauty will save the world." And Dostoevsky is in a school of thought which is not where most of us have been raised and are swimming in, which is that beauty is in the eye of the beholder. That you might think that sketch of Dostoevsky is beautiful and someone else might not, and that both of you have the equally valid opinion. Well, your opinions are both valid, but one of you might be right and the other one wrong, whether the thing is beautiful or not. That Dostoevsky is in the camp of thought, which is that beauty is not in, you're not the arbiter of beauty. Beauty is either in a thing or not. The way a thing is tall or short or purple, it's beautiful. Right? What is its height and weight? Is it beautiful? So I think what we would say is it's not that beauty is in the eye of the beholder. The ability to perceive the beautiful is in the eye of the beholder. But that beauty is a quality of a thing. Now, what do you mean by saved by beauty? He means that in an era where everyone is doubting everything, where everyone is suspicious that everyone else has an agenda, the state, we don't trust the state, we don't trust our politicians, we don't trust religious people, we don't trust business people, we don't trust people, rich people, we don't trust poor people, we don't trust, there's so much distrust. And especially all these things that used to tell human beings who they were and what makes life meaningful. He's going to say, where people are fishing around to figure out what it is to be human, that beauty will teach you that. It will teach you instinctively what it is to be human. And so in an era where you can't trust anything, beauty might be the thing that saves you. Because you can trust what it tells you about yourself and the response that you have to it. Okay. So what is it? Somebody, what is beauty?
Physical manifestation of the good.
A physical manifestation of the good. Can you use that in a sentence? it's a physical manifestation of the good. So if you're going to say to an artist says to you, "I need to start painting beautiful paintings," and you say, "Easy, it's a physical manifestation of the good." What does that artist say? You don't know, do you? It's like, what does that mean? I think you're right, but I don't know that there's a lot of help in that. For you guys when you go to museums to say, "I'm looking for physical manifestations of the good." Right? So it's like, well, what is it? It's like, I want to put a beautiful painting on this wall. Here's money. How would you go and find a beautiful painting? How would you know? Anybody? What would you do?
It brings you joy. It's something that brings you joy.
Yeah, but maybe you're nuts. Actually, it should. But to say, "I want you to go out there and find something that brings you joy," again, isn't very helpful. I like pork rinds. Yeah, it's great. Okay, you're cheating. You've heard me say this before. All right, good. So Grant says something that has harmony. All right, so we're getting towards, that's actually the beginning of an element, right? It's the beginning of a definition. Yes?
It's whole.
Okay, good. All right, yeah, well, you don't count either because you took my thing this summer. But no, all right, good. But so what the point I'm making here is, you had your hand back there.
I was going to say, does it express some sort of truth?
Okay, very good. So that's the three, whole, harmonious, and radiant. What I'm saying is that one of the problems we have, especially in the church today, we're surrounded by the banal and the ugly too often, it's because we don't even know what beauty is anymore. We only know what we like, you know, but not what we're talking about. So most people, if you say beauty, people think of this. Or this. Anybody been here? Cathedral of Sovieto in Italy? Yeah, you have? Yeah. This cathedral took 600 years to build. The doors are 3 stories high, bronze carving on them, and carving in the marble, and then the mosaics. And between them, the entire history of Revelation is on the facade of the Cathedral of Oviedo. But I say to you, if you went to your pastor and said, Pastor, I think we have a great idea to do something beautiful for our people, for the future, and he said, great, and you're like, it's going to be done in 600 years. How many pastors today would say, go for it? We wouldn't, because we don't think about the future and bequeathing things to the future like Christians used to. Okay, anyway, people would generally say this is beautiful. But the question I want to ask you, and hopefully by the end of tonight you should be able to have some kind of way of evaluating it, is what about these? Are these beautiful? Mm-hmm. How about this one? I mean, good grief. The most ugly thing you could depict in many ways, right? And yet, is it beautiful? But all of them. So, we're pushing towards that, okay? So let's stop and say, as somebody said, beauty is something that makes you feel joy. That when you feel joy, you have a sense that you've just encountered the beautiful. And that's valid. The word beauty comes from the Greek word kalon, which actually means to call. So in other words, one way of knowing you've been in the presence of the beautiful is if you're relatively normal and sane, I have to say that, right? That you feel personally engaged. You feel like this was a gift to you in some way. Now, you know, so the thing is, if I ask you what are some words of how this person here is feeling right now, what would, just throw them out, what would these words be?
Awe.
Hmm?
Awe. Small.
Small. Now that's an interesting one, isn't it? You mean small like, wow, I gotta jump off, I feel so small. You know, I was at school today, how was it? Well, they made me feel small. I mean, this is not usually reckoned a good thing. But in this sense, it is a good thing. What do you mean by small? How is it a good thing?
Puts you in perspective.
Okay, it gives you a sense of perspective. I didn't make this. It's here in front of me. And it's going to be here after me. I didn't add a thing to it except my praise. And so, there's a theologian of the late 20th century, early 21st century, named Joseph Ratzinger, who said beauty solves the problem of the Garden of Eden. What was the problem of the Garden of Eden? What was the temptation?
Tree of good and evil.
Yes, but specifically, what was the line? You will be like God. Right? And that's the temptation that sinks us. We don't want to be creatures. We want to be God. But when you experience beauty, you go, I'm not God, and it's okay, because I get this. Makes us at home. It makes us feel gifted in our creatureness. Okay, so pulling back, this is the classical definition of beauty. So from now on, if someone says, what is beauty? You can say, it's wholeness plus harmony plus radiance. That these are the 3 elements of the beautiful, according to classical philosophy. Modern philosophers, this has changed. But for all the people that we've focus on mainly in the right in the Honors College, in terms of the classical scholars, pretty much agreement. And there's different ways of saying these things. You know, completeness, harmony is sometimes said as proportion or unity. But basically, I find these three words helpful: wholeness, harmony, and radiance. Oh, by the way, I'm going to upload this to Sakai, so don't worry about, you know, scribbling too many notes if you want to just do that afterwards. You might in some cases, right? Now, before I go break these down and tell you what we're talking about, I just want to put three things out there. And this is from this philosopher, Tan Gilson, who wrote a lot about beauty. And he says, to apprehend the beautiful, and I don't want to say see, because sometimes we hear the beautiful, right? Or we taste it. You know, I'm Italian. So you apprehend the beautiful, but to even do that, you need three things. First, you have to be a person. You know, my cat is quite bright and an amazing among felines. Yeah. But he's never going to arrange his friskies around his bowl and then stand back and go, oh, look what I did, right? You know, this is beyond him. So you have to be a person. And then you need these three things. So the first one is sensitivity. So there's two senses of this. One is literally you have to be able to see and hear. You have to be able to taste and touch. But the more important one here is you have to be free of blinding prejudice and fear. You say, what does that mean? It's like, well, you know, for years after the Second World War, no one listened to Wagner. You know why no one listened to Wagner? Everyone had to hate Wagner.
He's German.
Well, he was Hitler's favorite composer. So it's like, Wagner has to stop now. Because, so it had nothing to do with Wagner's music. It was prejudice now. But you can imagine and say, you know, wow, I like this painting, and then I find out it was painted by somebody who I don't like politically. And so, you know, I'm cut off from this work of art. And fear. Why do you think fear gets in the way of our experiencing this thing that's calling us? Say beauty, we sometimes can't encounter it because we're afraid. Yes.
Sometimes it makes us face our own fate.
Mm-hmm. Like yeah. The thing about Kalan is I'm being called. And sometimes I don't want to be called. I don't want this thing to move me towards something that I may not want to go towards. Number two is intelligence. And so we mean here more than just, you know, as I said, as a person, you have a rational soul, and that's necessary. Here I mean of the art form, as opposed to being ignorant of the art form. But we talk about that all the rest of the time here, so I'll go into that more. And then finally, imagination. You have to have imagination, that you stand in front of a work of art, and you commune with the creator of it, through the medium. You stand in front of you and say, what is this thing saying to me? And you let it combine with your history, the person that you are, in your imagination, and you try to like meet the artist there. It's a process that happens in the human imagination. So a lot of times we can't experience what's to be had in art because we just don't have a good enough imagination. We have spent too many hours playing video games. All right, so, I say that out loud? Sorry, I hope I didn't make anybody feel uncomfortable. All right, so just to sum it up, the ideologue, the fool, and the clod cannot encounter beauty. So sometimes when somebody will have, you know, show someone something that's very beautiful, like the Pietà, and every so often I'll get a student who's like, you know, yeah, it doesn't work for me. And I'll be like, you just told me much more about yourself than the Pietà. Right, so be careful. Okay. All right, so let's break these down. A wholeness. Wholeness literally means that in a work of the, in something beautiful, and we're talking about art, there's nothing missing and nothing extra. that the work suggests completeness. Suggests completeness. So has anybody here ever been to Rome, seen the Sistine Chapel? A few? Yeah? You know, the rest of you have seen images of it, right? It's like with walking into the Sistine Chapel and going, needs more yellow. Oh well. Nice try. Nobody does that. If you did, get some therapy. Because the thing is, that you walk in there and all you can do is just go, right? It suggests something, many things, but not a lack, like there's something missing. To the same extent, there's nothing pasted on that doesn't fit there. And it's one thing we see in Hollywood all the time. I remember once my friend had a director and he had a thing going ahead at CBS. It was a TV movie. And the executive from the network came in and said, you know, this is missing something. Can we have like a decapitation before the 10 o'clock break? See, a decapitation before the 10 o'clock break? It's like, that's gonna fix it? No, what he was doing was he knows that watching someone have their head cut off gives a pulse to the audience. And he's like, you know, this thing is kind of missing a pulse. So let's just paste something on that will do that. And so you see this very often in when art isn't working, somebody tries to overcompensate by putting something extra on top instead of figuring out where it went wrong. Now, it gives the audience a sense of rest when they experience wholeness. What do we mean? Why? You know, it's because we are primed to detect completeness as the kind of being that we are. Why? Because we're meant to live with God forever, who is the complete one. He's missing nothing. And so we search our whole lives for mirrors of that thing that we were made for, completeness. And when we don't find it, you know, it's extremely disconcerting. You know, it's like completeness. Oh, no. Talk about not fulfilling your destiny as a work of art. Okay. You know, but it's like this. You know, I just tell my students, you feel funny when you don't, you know, when there's something missing, and it's just disconcerting. So, you know. Now.
What's wrong?
Now, when I say that, okay, see what's happening here? Now, if I go on, just to be irritating, and leave this here, you will sit here, some of you especially, please fill it in! Right? Please! And that's what we experience when something's missing. But when I come along and I go like this, right? Oh, thank God. You don't have to stare at it anymore. Now, sometimes art can deliberately leave things like that to provoke you. You know, but that's another question. But we're talking about the quality of the beautiful now. So when you do find something complete in the beautiful, it's like this. I feel at rest. So we're sending you out to museums. And they say wholeness means all the parts are present. And to apprehend the beautiful, you have to know what the parts are. You can't be ignorant of the art form. So one of the things you're going to say when you look at these paintings is, oh, that should be A, B, C. You talk about, you know, actually, I think there's one there that is white. Shape, color, and texture. Anyway, you get the point. When I put up to Zakaya, I was like, why it starts with B? How, oh, yeah, it's supposed to be lime. Oh, wait, hold on. Congrats. Okay, good. So now you go and you look at paintings and you say, okay, a painting has these elements. It has line, shape, texture, color, tone, and composition. So the first thing you do is say, one way to say if this is beautiful or not, does it have all of the elements of a painting? Is it missing any? But more often than not, things, they have them, but they're not whole because they have them in non-excellent or non-full way. Let's give you one example of music too, and then we'll look at that, right? So in the same way, say music now, we're gonna evaluate, we're gonna send you to concerts, we're gonna send you to the Disney Hall. How do you begin to say if this is a beautiful piece of music or not? Well, what are the elements? What are the essential elements that would make a piece of music whole? So I'm not a musician, but I found this online, and it makes sense to me, right? That beat and meter, dynamics, harmony, key, melody, pitch, tempo, texture, timbre, and then instruments, the voice or whatever it is the music is being delivered on. These are the elements. So you say, can you imagine a work of music without any sense of key?
Yes.
Or pitch?
Yes.
Or timbre, or melody, or yes. You know, or the textures, you know, we call this in movies a completely uneven movie, when the texture's all over the place.
Yes.
Movie texture means something different. But see, this begins for you to get you out of your ignorance, where you just sit there, and now you can start listening for, the meter. That was the meter. What is the melody here? What is the pitch? What are the things, right? Now, when you talk about a movie is the most complex art form there is, because it is the coalescing of the four great classical art forms. Movies are a combination of literature, story, performance, music, and visual composition. So I say this to you, and I try to make you understand how, this is why when you watch a movie and the credits, they go on for like a half an hour. Mm-hmm. It's because there are so many elements to a movie as a work of art. And so I just want to pull mine out and give you a sense of what we're talking about. We talk about fullness. That would mean a beautiful movie, just in my area, which is screenwriting, okay? So you have a screenplay, which is the literature part there, right? And a screenplay has a whole bunch of essential parts. It needs a title that reinforces the theme, etc. It needs a theme, it needs a plot, a structure, it needs an arena, a world. It needs characters and supporting characters. It needs what we call mise-en-scene, which is a description of the language of the production design. And needs dialogue. You say, so a beautiful screenplay needs all these parts, but here's the problem. Each of these parts has many parts. So if we just take plot, say, well, what are the parts of the plot? To be beautiful, a plot needs a beginning, a middle, and an end. It needs conflict, choices, complications, reversals, recognitions of moments of awe. These are just kind of the key essential aspects of the plot. So you say, I went to a movie and there were no complications. You know, like any Christian movie. This isn't strong enough to talk about Christian movies. But you know, or there's no reversals. That's a huge Christian movie thing. Just a straight line. this means something's missing. And you walk out of there and you're like, well, that was nice. You know, nice in Greek is the same word for stupid. Moron, actually. But the thing is, nobody comes out of the Sistine Chapel and says, well, that was nice. You know, it's like the beautiful should be more than just nice. It should shake you up in a prophetic way. So now here's the problem, though. Each of these have many parts. So let's just take the beginning. To be a beautiful beginning, a story needs to do all of this. Establish the rules of the world, introduce the protagonists, introduce the theme and the big idea of this. What is this movie about? It needs an inciting incident to launch the movie. It needs to establish the conflict, the antagonist. It needs a major reversal complication. It needs to set up the end. It needs to introduce all the subplots, the supporting characters, and it needs to set the tone, the slash tone genre. So an ugly beginning misses one or more of these because it's missing one of the essential parts. So when you talk about a beautiful movie, I just did the one here, screenplay, you know, up that way. Those are the parts. Performance will have its own set of boxes. This one's music. What does music do in a movie? It unites the project, it heightens the emotions, it reinforces the theme, it gives delight. This are the essential elements of the job of music in a movie, and you have to know that. So most of us were very ignorant in this art form, and we come out and say, well, I liked it. But if you talk to somebody who knows the art form, that's like, I like pork rinds. Like, yeah, well, what did you think? Did the production design, you know, mirror the theme? Huh? See, most of us don't know anything, really, about this art form, which is the most influential art form of our time. But we're kind of clocked about it. So that's, when I say that you have to get over your ignorance. If you ever want to experience the beautiful in an art form, you have to begin, you're going to pick one, painting or sculpture or music or dance or whatever. You're going to pick one and then you're going to master the parts so that you can really encounter it as beautiful. Instead of this like superficial level of, well, you know, gave me a charge or it didn't give me a charge. Like, believe me, if you start to learn stuff, it gives you a charge in all the right places and all the wrong ones from everybody else, right? Because you see things better. So that's where we're headed. Now, so completeness. We're still on wholeness here. And the idea of wholeness in beauty implies degrees of execution or a scale of excellence. This is part of wholeness. So it's more than just saying, does it have that thing or not? What you're starting to say is, does it have it in a very good degree or not? So this is a chart I found online, which I thought was great, which is a coach's chart of baseball excellence. In other words, a person playing baseball needs to know how to throw, field, hit, pitch, catch, bunt, and base running. Those are the elements of baseball. And in each of those elements, you have, you know, these different levels of mastery of the skill. So you can be a 2 in bunting and a 5 in base running and a 7 in catching and a 5 in pitching, etc. And you can be like a 1 in any of these, which means you are not playing in the major leagues. So when you go to play the major leagues, what you find are people that are all in the 5 to 7 level of, you know, of excellence. It's not that anybody doesn't do all of it. It's that in order to be beautiful as a baseball player, you have to really, really fall towards the end of the scale. So here's a chart of art, which I couldn't blow up anymore and make it legible, but these are all aligned, as they say. I'll put this on Sakai. You can find many of these. But this one says values and form, and it's a way for artists to evaluate, art critics to evaluate, you know, a work of art. And it's like, what is the form? What is the shape? What is the use of light? Etc. And they're saying, this painting, you know, it can use light either as a 1 or as a 4, or a 0 or as a 3, whatever. It can have shape as 0 as a, or a 3. So the beautiful is not just that the things are all there, but that they're there in an excellent degree. Yes?
How would you differentiate between completeness and perfection?
I wouldn't. Okay, next. I think that completeness is an aspect of perfection, especially when you're talking about beauty.
Okay.
It's one part of the beautiful. So you can have, is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So now what you're thinking is, who gets to decide if it's a 2 or a 3, right? Who do you think gets to decide if something's a 2 or 3? Who makes that call?
The Academy.
The Academy is quite interesting. Depends if it's an election year or not, right? You're on to something. I always tell people, pay attention to what the Academy says is the best work of the year. Because even when they are driven with a certain political agenda, they still are, they're pointing you towards something that is representative of great work. On the whole. But what you're saying is, people who do the thing at a high level, because you can only get in the Academy either by winning an Academy Award or being invited in because of your achievement, etc., right? So these are people who do it at a high level. Yeah. So, but somebody had their hand up over here? Yeah. Excuse me, experts in the field, right? So what's interesting is most people will say to me when I tell them this, you know what, it's everybody's different opinion. And I was like, yeah, tell that to a Major League Baseball coach. You know, I think his bunting is actually much better than you. I know he's never gotten on base, but you know, he has a heart in the right place. And I know he drops all the balls in the field, but he's passionate. And I think that should count for something. What do you say? We need outs! I need to get on base! Right? So it's interesting that we don't want to evaluate art today the way we evaluate skills and excellence in many other areas of life. But believe me, it wasn't always this way. Michelangelo, at the age of 14, was admitted to the greatest studio in Italy of the time, which he outgrew in a year. But the studio, the master, would be like, show me your stuff, kid, because I don't want crap coming out of my studio. Right? And so they used to be able to say, you got it. You have the skills. We can't say it anymore, and especially in the church, which is something to think about, huh? I don't know about your church, but you know, I'm a Catholic, so we've been suffering with music since the 1960s. You know, and as an act of charity, we will torture the sensibility. Charity for Doris and Stan who can't sing, you know, we'll torture the sensibility of 1,000 people every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. But this is kind of new. You know, there's no wall in St. Peter's Cathedral in Rome. You know, for Doris and Stan, who have a heart for the Lord but couldn't paint. But the church used to be able to say, you need skill. Now, the other thing I'm going to point you to is that there are abundance of tools online, an abundance, to help you evaluate the categories of aesthetic value in each of these art forms that you're going to be experiencing through the honors field trips. So if you're going to the Getty, it's like, what's at the Getty? Paintings and statues? And flowers, okay. We're horticulture as an art form, okay. Paintings and statues, right? So find one of these things online and bring it with you and say, you know, there should be more. And here's like, you know, like if I do that, I'll only see like three statues. I won't get through the whole place. And it's like, good, go back. But the three that you see, you will see in a whole other way than just walking through, like, oh, that one's cool. Oh, that one's neat. Yeah, I like that. Yeah, I don't know what that is. Yeah. Where's the cafeteria? Is there lunch around here or anywhere? Right. This is what usually happens to most people in museums because they don't know how to see. My friend is a docent in the National Gallery in Washington, and every year when I go there, I always say to her, can you meet me in, you know, the gallery and walk me through and we will talk and teach me. And usually what happens is, you know, I start with her and then I start moving faster and faster and my stomach starts to growl and I start getting bored. You know, I've looked at 50 paintings and then I'll realize my friend is gone. You know, Jem, her name is. And then I'll like walk back and she's like in the first room at the fourth painting, like this. You know? And I'll be like, Jem, tell me what you're seeing. And I remember one time I said this, and she said to me, can you believe how much paint he was putting on his brush? And I'll be like, yeah, you know, I didn't notice that. Didn't notice it at all. It went right over my head, this kind of technique that this artist was employing. So before you give up on things and say, that's not my cup of tea, have you really given it a shot? It might be a place where the beautiful is waiting to meet you, where God is waiting to meet you. But you have to exert your rational intelligence to learn so that you can see it. Have I convinced you? A little bit? I hope. Okay, that's wholeness. Number two is harmony. Harmony is all the parts are present, nothing's missing, and nothing's extra. But the relationship of the parts is one of complementarity. How do you understand a relationship of complementarity? So if I said to you, their marriage is complementary, what would you be hearing from me? Somebody.
They're friends.
Okay, kind of like it, as long as all your friendships are Aristotelian. Okay, they do things for each other. What things do they do?
Like they both serve each other.
They serve each other. You're on the right track. Yeah, Hannah, you shouldn't. Are you using this from the? She had this course for me this summer. So.
And maybe on Thursday, but that's okay. she does what he can't, and he does what she can't.
Very good. That's how they serve each other. Did you hear that? She does what he can't. And he does what she can't, and they bring out the best in each other, which is the second part of it. That a relationship of complementarity means I'm shining the light on you, and you're shining it on me. You're bringing out of me my best, and I'm bringing out of you your best. Now, when we experience complementarity, we experience joy. What did I tell you we experience when we experience wholeness?
Rest.
When we experience complementarity in the beautiful, we get happy. Now, I told you the reason we experience rest. were made to be with the one who is complete, and we're searching for that. Why do you think when we experience complementarity, we feel happy? You look like you're smart. What do you think? Maybe you're not. No, I'm kidding. What do you think? Why would you think experiencing complementarity makes you happy, makes your heart happy? Yeah, I am. Missing, yes. What do you got? Yes.
I was going to suggest that maybe it takes the places where you lack and it covers them over, and in a sense you realize, well, places where I lack, where anything lacks in the world, it isn't really that much of a problem because something covers it.
Something's going to cover me. I like that very much. It's actually, it's almost better than what I think the answer is. Yeah. I think it's actually a beautiful part of it. I mean, the thing is, in the same way that we were meant to be with the one who is complete, we are meant to be in eternal community, right? Mirror of the Trinity, we're meant to be drawn into the Trinity. And the Trinity is a perfect relationship without any domination, right? There's no control, there's no fear. It's a perfectly complementary relationship where everything is done together, and we are going to end up there someday. We were made to be there. So when we get glimmers of it in this life, we feel happy. Now, what happened? Went away. Nobody's doing that.
Maybe just click cancel, unless that is your
information. Let me see if I can just get rid of it. Okay. Yeah. All right, good. So, now, here's what I'm talking about. You know, what is complementarity in the beautiful, in works of art? So, suppose I was hired to carve a foot for a statue that was going to be, you know, a multi-person project. And my job is the foot. And in fact, my foot comes out the greatest foot that has ever been carved. It's stunning, my foot. And people come from all over to gaze on it. And so I call up the producer of the statue and say, my foot is ready. And he's like, great, great. You know, we have the rest of the 5-foot statue. I'm like, 5? I thought you said 50. He's like, no, the statue's 5 feet tall. And I'm like, never mind, my foot is perfect. It's so beautiful that just stick it on there. Now, what you've done here is create an ugly thing. Because even though my foot is of the top excellence, right, in those categories of footness, because it isn't harmonized with the whole, it renders the whole disharmonized, ugly. Mm. So the excellence of the parts in a work of art that's beautiful, it's not about them being necessarily the best they can be. It's about them being the best they can be in relation to the other parts. So this is why in a lot of movie projects, you know, that I work on, you have parts that overwhelm the whole, usually because one other part isn't working. And so I think of movies where the score, for example, the scores, job in a movie is to unify the movie, right? You give a kind of unifying themes that bridge the scenes. So it makes it feel like one thing to you. And the second job of music primarily is to heighten the emotions of the scene. But supposing the scene isn't working emotionally, it's flat, it's not producing any charge in the audience. So what they'll try to do is pump up the score. Have you ever been to a movie where that's like, boom, 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 and you're like, oh my gosh, stop, stop. Right? There was a movie called Amistad by Steven Spielberg, which, you know, has, I think, the greatest opening of any Spielberg movie ever, except perhaps Color Purple. But Amistad has an incredible opening. It's about this slave ship coming over from Africa. And then the movie devolves into a 2-hour seminar on property law in a courtroom case. And so what they do in that movie, because they realize that the movie just flattens out and we have lectures in a courtroom, is that they use this choral score. Oh, 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 oh. You know, there's Anthony Hopkins walking across the courtroom. And then it's like, you know, guys, this is disharmony. You're playing. Some actors have a reputation for overwhelming a project. Like Daniel Day-Lewis tends to overwhelm the rest of the cast in every movie he's in. And so a director really has to know how to handle that. This big actor, in terms of et cetera. But so that's one of the problems. You have a celebrity cinematographer comes on your project, and then it's about my images, right? And so this is where disharmony comes in a movie. Okay, now harmony. Are we doing good? Are you bored?
No.
Good. Okay. Harmony implies hierarchy. Harmony implies hierarchy. What do you think I mean by this? Yes.
Not every aspect holds equal weight.
Thank you. Thank you. So hair design in a movie is important, but it's not as important as the screenplay. And that's no diminution to the hair design. It's just that the harmony of the project is understanding that some of the parts are principal parts, and they play a more key role. And you have to know what those are. So Aristotle, in his Poetics, says these are the principal parts of a drama, a play. First is plot. What happens? And it has to have beginning, middle, end, reversals, recognitions, all that, right? That's the key thing upon which everything else hangs. In fact, he says, everything serves the thing that's below it, right? Everything that's below it serves the thing that's above it. Sorry. So in a play, everything serves the plot. Then you have the characters, and then theme. What is this thing about? What are we saying here in this project? What is Antigone really about? I mean, the plot is about a woman who wants to bury her brother, but what is it really about that makes it my story? Because I'm never gonna have a problem of fighting the state to bury my family members. But I can still read Antigone and it can be about me because of the theme. So Aristotle said, these are the first three, and then they're served by dialogue, music, and spectacle. Spectacle is the fun factor. Where's the enjoyment in this? We call it, you know, logos, ethos, and pathos is another way to talk about it. Logos being the smart thing, right? Pathos being the emotional part, and ethos being the fun thing. We call it heart, smart, and sparkle in the movie business. But you say, so this is how Aristotle says, this is a hierarchy, and it has to be harmonized around the hierarchy. Now, here's one of the reasons Hollywood movies suck since Jaws. Is because the hierarchy has gotten switched.
Spectacle's first, yeah.
The spectacle is the first one. What's we going to have to keep the pulse going? And then character, because it's a celebrity-driven business, so that one stays there. And then dialogue, because that's a huge thing for a movie, to export something into the culture that people are quoting from a movie. I'm the king of the world! Right? Dialogue, that it's pithy, memorable, it's very, very important. And of course, it's related to the actors, so that's why it's so important here. Plot has become very unimportant. You don't really sell a movie based on what happens anymore. You sell a movie based on, you know, what's going to make my heart beat? What are we going to look at? What are we going to see that we haven't seen before? And then music, always. And then theme is, most of the time, doesn't even come up anymore when you go into production companies and pitch stories. And I told you, what is theme? What is theme? That makes it my story. This is why you go to so many movies and you walk out and you're like, yeah, anybody hungry? Because you were witnessing something. You weren't sharing in it. Mm. It never became your story. So Hollywood currently is in a mess because they've lost all sense of the hierarchy around which the elements should be harmonized. Okay, the last aspect of the beautiful is radiance. Radiance. We said wholeness, harmony, and radiance. Radiance is the moral, spiritual, or intellectual enlightenment that inheres in a work of art or a beautiful thing. The moral, spiritual, or intellectual enlightenment. Now, I told you wholeness satisfies, gives you a sense of rest. Complementarity, harmony gives you a sense of
joy.
Radiance gives you a sense of the truth. Your own nature as a rational being. You go, that was satisfying. It's good to know. Now, just as a little on the side here, you know, I work with a lot of Christians doing hot projects in the movie business. In fact, almost exclusively, it's my cross. And what I find is they're so eager to save the world by the message in the project. And I say to them, you know what? If you make something whole, harmonious, and radiant, you are giving such an incredible gift to the audience of peace, joy, and understanding that painting the Bible quote on the top is like a lesser thing at this point. But what's funny is we'll have the Bible quote in the movie and not these other things. Okay, so that's just every so often I have to rant about that. Okay, now, radiance is meaning, not message. Mm. The famous line from Samuel Goldwyn, if you want to send a message, hire a Western Union. One of the original studio owners. Story, art needs to mean something. But the meaning is not going to be in a movie or a story, a line of dialogue. It's going to be the journey of the story itself. And it's the same thing with any work of art. The meaning of a symphony isn't something I can hand you in a line. It's the journey of the symphony that you and Cal, you experience together. And when you do, it's this amazing moment, they say, carved in ice, because it will never happen again. Mm-hmm. The person that you are in that moment, you open yourself, and that music comes into you, and you encounter it with vulnerability, without prejudice, and fear and everything, you encounter it. And then if you listen to it tomorrow, it's different because you're different. As you grow, these works will mean more to you, beautiful works, because you're moving. Now, you have to be willing to go on the journey of the art itself, which means a commitment of time and sacrifice. Flannery O'Connor, they used to ask her all the time, what does your story mean? What does your story mean? And she used to say, if I could say it in a sentence, I wouldn't have written the story. Right? And then that is a perfect way to summarize this. So a story's meaning, and I would say it this way, a work of art's meaning is the organizing principle of the method, tone, style, and structure of the thing. It's like, the artist is trying to communicate this. I'm dancing around this big idea that jealousy kills. Say it's that, you know, Shakespeare's Othello. I'm dancing around this idea. And that's the idea around which everything else gets organized and finds its organization. Okay, radiance is, here's some qualities of it. I say the parts have parts. Well, the parts of radiance are the qualities of radiance. It's inarticulate. Now, usually when I say, you are inarticulate, I'm not giving you a compliment, right? But in this sense, I'm saying we have no words, not because the thing is deficient, but because we, in our language, is deficient. We don't have words to express what a beautiful thing is communicated. It goes above that. Universal? Radiance is universal. It's beyond the limits of time and culture. So in other words, with a beautiful thing, it's like, oh, well, that's good for Chinese people. It's like, no. It's going to work with everybody, in every time, in every age, insofar as they're sensitive, intelligent, and what was the third thing? Oh, yeah. And not fearful, right? Sensitive, intelligent. But we're talking about universality, where this thing is speaking to me on the level in which I'm human. Profound, radiance is profound. You know, you don't get a beautiful work of art that says to you, broccoli is good. It's not the kind of meaning that radiates out of a beautiful work of art. It's another kind of message about the big truths. And it's true. It's beyond fear, pride, and sloth, which is usually the things that keep us, veil us from the truth. Say, wait a minute, can't I have a beautiful lie? No, you can't. You can have an effective lie, a compelling lie, a powerful lie, a haunting lie, but it can't be beautiful in the sense that we are talking about, which is spiritual, intellectual, or moral enlightenment. Okay, how about that? So now when I say all those things, now you do this and you say, so you're going to look at, this is a photograph. Photography. My husband's getting his MFA in photography. So you say, wholeness, harmony, radiance. What does this radiate? And you start throwing out words. Hope, power, sovereignty, majesty, diversity, unity, right? All of them are true, but none of them are the painting. And none of them, and even all together, they're not the photo. Because language is inarticulate. That's why we have this other medium to encounter the truth. And almost done, and then take a quick break, and then we come back and talk just about movies. Right? All right. More beautiful versus less. This is pretty much the last quality. You say, what makes something more beautiful and or than something else? Supposing they're both beautiful, they both have wholeness, harmony, and radiance in a, that they have all the these aspects and they have them in all the parts in a high degree of excellence. Well, it's complexity. So, this is beautiful. This photo of this thing. And anybody ever been here? The Basilica of Zaragoza in Spain? No? Yes, yeah. Stunning. It's so beautiful that when the Spanish Civil War happened, the communists bombed it directly twice because they knew the simple existence of it was a proof that God exists. It's so unbelievable. They have a six-story alabaster altarpiece. I mean, most of the time you see alabaster, you see like a little thing, right? But you know what happened, by the way? They bombed it, direct hit. They had lined all the people of Zaragoza around the cathedral on the hill. They bombed it, direct hit, and they had put, by the way, all the clergy and the really hardcore Christians in the basilica, in the cathedral, chained around the altar, so they would all go up in a big, you know, bomb. And they dropped the bomb, and it went right through the ceiling and fell on the floor and went boink, 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 boink. So they said, do it again. There was a dud. So they flew another pass, dropped it through the ceiling, doink, 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 doink. And they were so freaked out, they let everybody go. And the communists fell on their knees. And what's neat, when you go to Zaragoza, there are two holes in the ceiling still, and the two bombs on both sides of the main altar. You walk in and you're like, what in the world?
Did they even dewire them? Or?
I hope not. No, I don't know. I mean, I would almost say no, but it's the point, you know, I don't know. I imagine somebody insisted on that. But the point is, it's a miracle, this place, and God could not let it go. Right? It seems to me. But anyway, so what I'm saying is, look at the turrets here. It's a massive, massive thing. The size of this, almost this whole East Campus. From end to end. And so you say, well, this is beautiful, but this is more beautiful, so much more, and many more elements have been harmonized here. So much more complex. Now, there is a scenario by which this, in its massiveness, could be uglier than this. You know, the Los Angeles Catholic Cathedral. Anyway, all right, now, so summing up here, beauty is not cute. Pretty, facile, easy, it's not derivative or sloppy, it's not disproportionate or sentimental, it's not cheap, non-threatening, it's not a lie. And it's often how we use, you know, we'll say things are beautiful and we're just, that's not what that word means. Now you know. Now, the problem is that you like or don't like something, you know, that is, you have an emotional response to it or you don't. It doesn't say anything about it. Hopefully you get that now. You can adamantly insist that this is the greatest dancing that has ever existed on Earth. But you'd be wrong. And I can prove it to you over time, but it would require you to submit yourself to learn the art form. Okay, good. So we're going to take a couple minute break here, and then my goal is to have you done by 8:15. Okay. But we got to talk about just the movies, because that's what we're looking at. I want to give you four things by which you can look at movies and evaluate them, okay? So 5 minutes. And I might start a clip from the movie I want us to talk about. get any better than that in the movies. Because Pixar is doing it at a level that we can only dream. And I'll tell you, one of the reasons I'm saying that is that they change tone completely in this little, like, 3 minutes. You laugh a couple times, right? You laugh at the beginning where you see his family and her family, and then his family, right? What are they telling you there about marriage?
Opposites attract.
Just two worlds come together. They're different, huh? But then you laugh at that, and then you laugh when she goes, I want as many babies! Right there, all the clouds are babies! And the guy goes, oh! Right? But then he looks at her and he's like, fine. You know, with you, it'll be great. And you laugh. And then they're painting the nursery, and then the tone changes. She's sitting outside with her back to him, and that just gets right to your gut. And then the end, she touches his face and gives him the book, Still Have Adventures Without Me.
Oh.
Now, I mean, and didn't you feel like crying, huh? Feel the emotion. Usually in any movie it has a genre and you build towards one emotion, you plateau off of it and you start building again. Very hard to have a movie where you are having these contrary emotions, laughing and crying. You can do it in 2 hours. Pixar did it in 3 minutes. It's crazy good. But so we talk about the four elements. The music, did you notice how the music unified the sequence, right? It's like, this is one story. And because we kept having that theme playing over it, it made it feel like one thing, even though you're editing together all these separate parts from different eras, different looks and everything, right? What else did the music do? It really heightens the emotion. So when you cut from her, them painting the nursery, and then the palette, well, we'll get there, but then the doctor's office is out there, right? You notice the music? Dun, 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 dun. You know, it got very simple, almost just one note, yeah. All of the music just kind of faded down to that, and they do that again. So the music here is absolutely doing its job. How about the composition? The look of it. Did you see how the colors were used for moments of joy and then moments of sorrow? It becomes very dark. The palette gets like almost kind of monotone.
The shapes.
The shapes, right? What's the principal shape? There are two principal shapes in this thing, right? Okay, well, the triangle, but the house, right? The square, and then the balloons. The square and the circle, the square and the circle. And that's, again, this theme. What is this piece about? Okay, so now we're there. Story. What is the theme of this story? What do you think it's about? Don't have to be really put in the right words, but what is this thing about?
Love.
I'm going to say marriage. It's really about marriage. That I'm brooding over what marriage is when it's good. And that everybody wants in on that marriage, don't you? Don't you want to find that person? Even though you know it's going to kill you at the end to lose them, that makes life worth living. To find that. So that's the big idea of this piece. But look at it as a story. Beginning? They have a beginning? Yes? Very clear. When does it transition kind of out of the beginning? When does the beginning stop and then the middle really start to happen? Yes?
The doctor's office.
Okay, very good. Their lives change when this ever-present sorrow of we're not going to be able to have children enters in. This is now the middle, the second act. Because up to then, it was fun. Everything's fun and happy and delightful. Big dreams, everything we can have. And then it's like, no, you're not, your dreams are not going to play out the way you think. Some of them will not happen. That's the second act. And then what's the end? What transitions into the end? One of the most lovely transitions I've ever seen. The ties, thank you. We go through the eras. The time of the young man's tie to the older man's tie to then the elderly man's tie. And then you pull back and now he's old and she's old, but none of you went, who are those people? Right? They did what's called this match cut, this association that they brought you along. They didn't have to have a name tag. You got it. That's unbelievable storytelling to keep you with them while they made these characters that don't look anything like the ones you were seeing before, right? But you immediately then transfer all the emotional connection you had with them as young into these two because of this tie thing. So now we're in the end of the story and clear end, right? She dies. So there's a couple of cool things in the beginning. They're climbing the mountain together. She gets to the top first in the first act. And she's like, come on. And he's lagging behind. At the end, she's lagging behind. The movie opens with a flash of the flashbulb. And it ends with this dark kind of spinning going out. These are all devices that were put in there compositionally to reinforce the theme and to keep you focused and following. Now, spectacle. So that was story, music, composition we talked about, and performance. Did you connect with these characters? Were you watching them and saying, oh, that's interesting? Or were you feeling emotion like it was you? Were you witnessing this or sharing it? That's performance. That the actor makes you think this is my story. That's great acting. So, they're all here. Now we'll talk about the other thing, heart, smart, and sparkle. Something to learn here, something to radiate. Do you feel smarter after watching this in some way? Not necessarily like the way you do when you read a great book. And yet, don't you feel enlightened by this? I'm glad I experienced that. It put something in my mind that I hadn't really thought about. Even if you're not conscious of it, this changes you about love. And how about pathos? Absolutely. You've got to be a rock not to feel something. If you didn't, go get some help. Just saying, no, I'm only kidding. All right, yeah. But I mean, this is an amazing emotional journey in this teeny compressed little thing. And it's okay to feel. Tolkien said when he was asked, why do you write stories? He said, because people are trapped in their mundane lives where they're just kind of going like this without any highs or lows. And my stories allow them to, they free them from the prison of the mundane world and allow them to experience the full breadth of their emotions. Fear, terror, joy, outrage, passion. That's one of the things that art does for us, is it allows us to experience the range of our nature. Well done, okay? And then sparkle. Was this fun? Yeah, fun, you can't look away. It's entertaining. And entertainment, in the French word means the work between the work, entretenement, the work between the work. In other words, the work you do with recreation makes your workaday world livable. Your recreation should be a change of occupation, something that stretches you and makes your banal life livable. The demon of technology. Okay, all right, good. Now, so, quickly, here we go. Really fast summary of a 22-week course in 10 minutes. Okay. these are when we watch these movies together, I'm going to ask you, these are the things, the five things that movies need to be beautiful. So something to see. There's this visual aspect. I'm going to say a little bit more about that. Mainly the visual aspect of movies is that they're choices. That we're watching, as Aristotle said, we're watching, it's the imitation of men in action. So if a movie is really talky, it's a bad movie. We're not supposed to sit there and watch people talking in their car, talking in their living room, talking in a bar, talking in a... No, they're supposed to be doing things. Am I watching action? And then number two, what's the arena? What's the world here? What is there to see? Does this need to be a movie, or could it just have been a book or a short story? Why does this need to be a movie? Because I have to see it. Number two, something to learn. Principally the big idea, the theme. This is the radiation from it, huh? But, so that's the mass appeal. Why do people want to go to see this of all ages and in all countries? Because it's about them somehow. And number two, literally new information. That we want to learn stuff about what it's like to live in the Yukon. Oh, is that what they eat? Cool. Right? Oh, is that where people in Minnesota live in the winter? Okay, cool. Right, that there's an aspect to learning that's fun for us in this medium. Aristotle says the principal attraction of plays is the instinct for imitation, the instinct to learn by watching other people live. That we're drawn to it as an instinct, the way a duck is, driven to fly south. That's you going to a movie or a play, reading a novel. You're driven to it by an instinct. Huh? Something to feel. A movie needs got to engage your emotions. It should move you. And you say, well, wait a minute. I thought you said that wasn't any standard. Well, there needs to be the engagement of the emotions of a normal, sane person who's got some knowledge of the art form. There should be some, it should work on you. Because in art, we go through the heart to the brain. In books, we go through the brain, hopefully, to the heart. Okay. Something to enjoy. Even if it's awful, Shakespeare's plays, Romeo and Juliet, you weep copious tears. These young people, wasted. Aristotle says, the more you make the audience suffer, the more they will love you. Right? Isn't that true? That's so great. Right? That great, great story. It makes you cry, it makes you suffer, but it's enjoyable. And then finally, something to dream, something to share, to export, to talk to others about. But we say a great ending feels like a new beginning, where people go out and they're like, what has happened next? So you tell an audience a story up to this point, and a great ending, you can't stop thinking about it. You start telling your own story. What happens next? The origin of movie sequels when they were good, right? Okay. Now. Okay. Specifically now, here are the areas of you watching these movies we're going to watch and say, is it good? The first question you ask yourself is, what is it? Now, these are the three principal kinds of movies. A movie as art, movie as story, and movie as entertainment. American cinema doesn't have a lot of the top one. Our cinema went to follow the storytelling. D.W. Griffith, the father of American cinema, said, I want to do with the movies what Dickens did with stories. So American cinema became telling stories and becomes the love of the whole world, by the way. American cinema becomes beloved of the whole world. European cinema went after the art, the painting world. So you have movies in European cinema that are like cubist, you know, neorealist. And, you know, you like them or you don't. But they're not, for the masses, they aren't, they don't, they become, they're almost too much work for the masses. The masses want stories. And then finally, this happened since, you know, since the 12-foot latex shark ate six tourists in 1975, this became American, the blockbuster era movie, where it's mainly about a pulse, an emotional rush, a charge. And that trumps the story factor. It absolutely trumps. They're not even trying to do that art thing. Now, here's the tricky thing. A great movie is all three. If I say to you, you know, The Incredibles, is this entertainment? Yes. Is it art? Indubitably. Absolutely. And I can prove that to you. Is its story. Oh my gosh. There are seven distinct story narratives in The Incredibles, where characters move from here to here. Finding Nemo has two main protagonists who each have a beginning, middle, end on a different lesson and come together at the end for their joint resolution. That is freakishly great. Most writers can't make one person come in a convincing way, right? So, but you know, Pixar spends 14 to 18 months on the story before they go into anything else, which nobody knows, right? So anyway, Apocalypse Now, Godfather, the greatest movies are all three. Number two, the second criteria of cinema is the screenplay. The screenplay is the blueprint for the whole project. So what I'm going to say to you, how is the writing here? I don't just mean the dialogue. I mean, was the story engaging? The story. Was it complete? Was it worthy? Was it worth telling the story? Was it surprising? Were the characters true? Were they compelling? Were they relatable? Is there a theme? Is there subtext here, or is it all just on the surface? Is there anything going on? Is there any mystery in this thing? Is the dialogue better than real speech? Dialogue in a movie is not like real speech. It's better. So when you go to see, you know, a movie, people say about Christian movies all the time, one of the critics' critiques is, people don't talk like that. They're too preachy. Well, the truth is, in movie dialogue, people don't talk like that either. But it's better than how people talk. So Christian movies don't even attain to the real. Never mind the better than the real. But honestly, think about Casablanca. Supposing you said to your boyfriend, why are you breaking up with me? And he said, someday you'll thank me. Maybe not today. Maybe not tomorrow, but someday soon and for the rest of your life. Here's looking at you, kid. You'd be like, what are you smoking? Right? But in a movie, it's better than the real. It's beautiful. So, okay. Now, I want to watch one more clip here, a couple more, but this one's my favorite scene from The Mission. And this is the scene of Gabriel, the Jesuit, is going up to the Guarani, who are a tribe of cannibals who have martyred a whole bunch of missionaries. And so he's trying a different approach. This is how we meet Father Gabriel, this character, really, in the movie. So what I'm asking you is, this is a screenplay. This is a screenplay that's fleshed out by performance and all the other elements, but the writer wrote it first. Robert Bolt, the greatest ever, he wrote Lawrence of Arabia, he wrote Man for All Seasons, he wrote Dr. Zhivago, and now he writes The Mission. But I want to ask you, what a cool way to tell you who this character is. Okay, so let's just watch it, and you tell me if you know who Father Gabriel is. Okay, remember I told you movies are about men in action, choices? That's what this scene is. Throw out some words, things you know about Father Gabriel now from this scene. You just met him. Who is he? Give me some words.
Brave.
Brave, very good. What else?
Smart.
Patient. Smart.
Determined.
Hmm? Somebody else say one?
Determined.
Determined.
Peaceful.
Peaceful.
Skilled.
Skilled. Educated, huh? I couldn't do that on a whatever's that thing. I don't even know what that thing is. You know? He's loving. You know more about Father Gabriel than you do about her. Isn't it true?
Yeah.
If I told you, you know what happens next? Father Gabriel goes like in a little side room and tortures some animals, you know, just to get his tension out. What would you say to me?
No,
no way!
No.
But if I said to you, she's gonna do that, you're like, I don't know. Right? So what you just saw there was a screenplay genius. The screenplay genius where the writer came up with a choice that was so creative and brilliant that it told you who this character was. That's writing. So that's the kind of thing I'm going to ask you to look for in terms of how well written was this, not just the dialogue. And yeah, we got to skip through all this stuff. Yeah, got to go through this. Okay, we mentioned another thing. How was the visual aspect of this movie? Did it need to be done as a movie? So the arena where it's set, it can't just be a standard location, a bar or a courtroom. It has to be this bar, this courtroom, this classroom. And then the stuff you're seeing, so this is from Tree of Life. It's a movie about isolation in the modern world. This is one of the images. Do you see how the composition supports the theme? We don't have time for that. The fourth aspect, is this a unified thing? Are all the parts building towards this big idea? Are they all supporting it? Are there stuff that just like, what was that? That didn't fit in this movie. What is this movie about? Can you walk out and say what this theme is? Even in an inarticulate way, which it has to be, but still some way of expressing that. If you can't, you know, there's two options. You weren't paying attention. You know, you're a clod or an ideologue or a, you know, whatever. Or the movie's a mess. I saw the movie Silence a couple weeks ago, and I said to the producer after I saw it, I said, you know, the movie was both. It was like saying being a Christian missionary is a good thing and then saying it's a waste. And he goes, that's the genius of it. He's like, I think Scorsese is doing both. I said, that's the definition of the loss of creative control. I walked out going, what the heck was that? Not in a good way. You know, we say in the movie business, ambiguity, good. Confusion, bad. Okay, and then I was going to show this clip from Kessel, but we don't have time. So, ending off, which I'm now 10 minutes late. No time for questions, really. I'll hang around for a few minutes after, unless anybody want to throw one out there. I've thrown a lot at you tonight, but here's the good news. We're going to learn about cinema through the semester. While we're watching these things, I'm going to learn to help you become more expert in reading a movie. It's one of the reasons to come, and if you want to be smart about the movies, come to the series. Huh? I promise you, you'll learn a lot. Thank you so much for your Sunday night.